We also just got the message through our line.
Yeah, like the other day, so like I actually.
Yeah.
Or they just want your application.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work.
True, but also.
Oh, and then you have to get half like somewhere.
Oh, yeah, I had that too.
Yes. Oh, cool, interests of people in ASU.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well.
Oh, that's like so, yeah, yeah.
That's the most, that's the.
Yeah, I have like.
University.
Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah, yeah, I like it.
I'm like, I'm saying like.
You're not my real son.
Really, is it like the drama that's huge this summer?
That's my kid, that's like awesome. You'll have to send me like pictures as you make progress.
Yeah, I mean, he's virtual. It's as much as this is do it for small talk.
And then like also.
I hate that crap so much.
And the USA. Equal service workers.
I am crushed. I saw this Maria said that would one where they got 50 points. That's crazy. Really.
Oh, this is like everyone else probably.
Wow,
this is yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's really cool.
Let's go slow.
Is your purse?
Of course. I think so. I have to like find out where our
is Jeff playing? Yeah, so good. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And probably Maria.
I know her.
That tomorrow is that I got like the first answers to those questions. I think I'm
thank you.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay. So we are going to get started. So today is sort of the last class for MDPs as just inference. Next class, we'll start thinking about combining the models, learning models, as well as inference. So reinforcement learning, as I said last time, is basically continuation of MDPs, where you also learn the models. You learn the transition and reward function. One tricky thing, I mean, I don't know if any of you have actually watched the reinforcement lecture that I asked you to watch. You should have it done by Thursday, because we'll actually be talking about reinforcement learning starting Thursday. But one very interesting thing in reinforcement learning is, if all you need to do is to do the optimal policy, you don't actually have to learn the model. You can just do without thinking. And from the perspective of this course, that would be a reflex agent. You learned directly a reflex agent, which just knows, if I'm in this state, I should do this. If I'm in this state, I should do this. Remember that once you get the policy, that's what you'll do. You'll just follow the policy. If I'm in this state, I'll do this. The interesting thing is, we got to the policy in the case of MDPs by actually starting with the transition model and the reward metric, and then basically talked about how to convert it into a policy. But it turns out that if you're just learning from an agent's behavior, or if an agent is trying to learn from its own behavior by actually walking around in the world, it can figure out what is the right thing to do without actually taking the intermediate step. That's actually probably the most interesting part of reinforcement learning coming from MDP side, in the sense that sometimes those are things called model-free reinforcement learning. So you know what to do, but you can't think about what to do. Do you understand what I'm saying? So the classic example would be something like swimming or bicycling, where you know when you're in a particular position, what's the right action to do. If you learned swimming, you kind of learned the optimal policy of not sinking, essentially. But if I ask you in like textual form, if you are in this place and you are 15 meters below the water and the following things are happening, what should your action be? you have no idea. Just I do it. And if you ever say I do it, then you're doing model free. You must have done model free infrastructure. And if you have the model, the advantage is without doing, you can think in your world, what will happen if I were to do something? That is model-based reasoning. Much of what we did up until now is model-based reasoning. You know, A-star search gave a model, the cost model, and you figured out what's the optimal sequence, optimal path. MDP, I gave you the transition and the reward model, and I'm figuring out what is the optimal policy. But it turns out that if you're just learning directly, you can just learn the policy. And one of the interesting things is, in some cases, not computing the model could be a problem for you because then you are unable to actually sit in one place and think about what will happen. Can you simulate it in your head? The beauty of simulating the world in your head is it's always ergodic. You see what I'm saying? Right? If you die in your dream, you're still alive when you're awake. Except in Inception, where apparently all sorts of corner cases can happen. Okay. But in general, that's the beauty of simulation. That's why we think, you know. But having said that, there are certain things we think, you know, we are able to project in our minds. Certain things we just know how to do, things like swimming. And so that's kind of becomes interesting when you get to reinforcement learning. But enough of that. But today we will still talk about Markov decision processes, which still are the substrate on which reinforcement learning is understood. Okay. So I had a couple of questions here. If anybody has answers, why is an MDP called a Markov decision process? What's the deal about Markov in Markov decision process? Yes?
Like Markov chains, right? I don't know anything about this.
So why, what is Markov chain? So anybody heard of Markov chains? Right? You heard of Markov chains. So what is the connection between Markov chains and Markov decision processes?
Markov chains are that you only decide the next action based off the state that you're currently in.
I mean, the Markov chains is what you're saying. Unfortunately, that's not true. Anybody else? Yes?
Doesn't the Markov mean that it's memoryless? So it's not dependent.
So you're answering the separate question, which is why is there like two parts here? One is why Markov? And the second is what's the connection, which I didn't ask, but you guys brought up. What's the connection between Markov chains and Markov decision processes? It's also an important question. Right, the last time you heard of Markov, if at all, you know, was when with respect to Markov chains. If you hang around, you'll keep hearing about Markov like all the time in AI. So we should kind of understand who the heck this Markov guy is, kind of, you know, looks like the hero of these sorts of areas. So your answer was with respect to the property, Markov property is what he was defining. The Markov property is that your optimal action in a state depends only on the state, not how you got there. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's a beautiful thing to be able to say that optimal action depends only on where you are, not how you got there. That's the Markov property. Okay, and clearly we are using the Markov property because if Markov property doesn't hold, optimal action from state S depends only on S. Yes.
I guess it's just like a clarity thing for me. Would a normal A-star search not have the Markov property since it depends on the cost so far?
No, it's because A-star search, that's the what you're confusing is, what is the policy in A-star search? The policy in A-star search is a partial policy, which says for the states that are on the optimal path, what is the action to do? And it just tells you what action to do there. You see what I'm saying? Notice that I did not say, I mean, please understand the distinction. I didn't say that since if I have a, like a big Markov process and I want to know the optimal value in the state, I'm not saying you can just ignore the rest of the Markov, the rest of the puzzle and just look at that state. That's not what I'm saying. In fact, you know that makes no sense because the optimal policy in a state depends on the rest of the states. Right? If this state next to it, it's a neighbor, it should go there. I'm not talking about the computation of the policy. I'm talking about the execution of the policy. At the time of execution, if you ask yourself, what should I do in this state? You don't need to say, how did I get to this state? Like this poor woman, apparently somebody washed up on a like a European shore yesterday and she didn't remember her name, nothing. Right, so the question then is, what's her optimal action? If it's a, if she's in a Markov world, her optimal action just depends on the fact that she's on the beach at that point, not how she got there. Computation of optimal policy, on the other hand, takes the entire state space into account. It's a very, very important thing. Again, one of these problems is that it looks like we're not doing enough calculations in the class, right? I mean, where are the numbers? Why aren't we multiplying? That's the least interesting part. I mean, you should be able to multiply stuff yourself, you know, but these are things that most people don't understand, you know, exactly what is Markov about Markov Bayesian processes. The policies are memoryless, state memoryless. That means the policy tells you, if you're in this state, do this. In general, actually, if you remember long, long back about the way we studied, when we talked about rational agents, we basically said something like this. S1, blah, 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 SK is the history given the percept history. Okay. The percept history, SP1, etc., SPK, then you do action. Okay. That means it's taking the entire history to decide what its action should be. A Markov essentially says, I don't care how you got to SK. You are in SK, so you should just, there should be like a table telling you, if you are in SK, do this action. A second order Markov says, I'll remember your two states, last two states. A third order Markov, last three states. Basically, non-Markov means history matters. And some kind of a fully non-Markov means your entire history matters. Right? I mean, so people have said that the old European aristocracies and various other things, it didn't matter what your quote unquote your merit is, it mattered how you got that merit, you know, what was your entire lineage. And like a big deal about US and some of the newer countries was, you could care less how you got here. Now you are here, now you have this, you know, the action, that the optimal action for you or optimal valuation for you just depends on that one. So that's like a strange way of thinking that, you know, my what I do with you doesn't depend on how you got here. Okay, that's Markov property. So the next question is, what's the difference between Markov chain and Markov decision process? Somebody else. The guy who said Markov chain. What is a Markov chain?
All I know is that's used for like generating like text by the connecting. I think it's a probability of like things ending up next to each other.
Yeah.
That uses those to like generate something. I know people use it to generate like text and like images.
So what is the difference between that and Markov Bayesian process? Anybody else? Yes.
Chain like doesn't make decisions, right? Just
yeah, that one part that's different is decisions. We will. If you are watching his life, it's a Markov chain for you. If you're watching your life as if you have no free will, then you converted a Markov decision process of your life into a Markov chain, saying, I don't know what to do. I just see what happens to my life. You understand what I'm saying? Markov decision process, a Markov chain is essentially you are seeing certain behaviors. You know, you saw the system exhibit state S1, then state S3, then state S7, then state S9, etc. You see a whole bunch of these sequences. You can compute the probability that S3 will come after S1, or S7 will come after S8, etc. That would be the state transition probabilities. If you remember Markov chains give you state transition probabilities. Given the state transition probability, there is a steady state distribution of occupancy of states. That's called the Markov chain equilibrium. This is what I'm saying. And in fact, if you want to remember why anybody should care about Markov chains are all over the place. Google PageRank. Any of you heard of Google PageRank? Google PageRank is essentially views your behavior on the web as if you are a random surfer and you're going from page to page to page. And it tries to compute, given you're in a particular page, what is the probability that you can go to some other page? And that will give you the Markov chain, and then it computes that stationary distribution of the Markov chain. And in general, Markov chains are very useful if you're trying to figure out what other people are doing. Because you can't tell them do this action. You're just seeing what's going on. Somebody's MDP is somebody else's Markov chain. Understand what I'm saying? That's a beautiful way to remember. Oftentimes, nature's MDP is your Markov chain. Okay, but sometimes, you know, some people basically are going around, they have individually making free will based decisions, but you still see as an observer, this is a Markov chain. I have some some probabilities, I can compute equilibrium state distribution. It's the decision part of Markov decisions that's extremely important. If any of you heard of this old Reebok commercial, Reebok used to have commercials. I'm that maybe it's because I'm too old, but Reebok actually the picture itself looks very old. But anyway, so Reebok, the shoes guys would always end their commercial this way, because life is not a spectator sport. You got to do something in life. You can't just keep here watching what's going on in the life. So the geek version of this is because life is not a Markov chain. It is an MDP. You see what I'm saying? The hardest thing computationally for an agent is to have a choice. If you have a choice, I can tell you, you screwed up, you made the wrong choice. If on the other hand, you believe in this meta theory that you are but a mere spectator, and gods and goblins are deciding what happens to you, then you can never be wrong, essentially. It's the gods and the goblins who are wrong. You are a detached observer of your own life. Looks like these days I'm failing my exams. I would not talk about the fact that I'm not sitting down and studying. It's just, I'm a dispassionate observer of my own life. And that's not life. Life is not a spectator sport. Life is not a Markov chain. It is a Markov decision process. Other people's life, to you, is a Markov chain. You will hear about Markov chains and all sorts of other places. This is just a beautiful connection. Right? If you, for example, your agent has computed an optimal policy, your Markov MDP agent, and it's following this optimal policy, somebody watching it, we'll essentially see a Markov. And they can talk about what are these agents, what is this agent more likely to be hanging around at? Like, for example, I mean, we know that you go to a donut shop, there'll be cops. That's because, you know, the cops computed their optimal policy, which apparently involves going to donut shops. You know, and so as far as you're concerned, you can make expectations about somebody else's free will decision. Okay, any questions? So again, you combine different parts of your life. That's the whole point of study, of education. Okay, you could do hacking where, you know, this is a Markov chain code I'm doing, this is a Markov decision process code I'm doing, this is a partially observable Markov decision process code I'm doing, this is a star code I'm doing. What's the connection? That's the thing that you should understand. The next question, of course, is who is this guy Markov? This is Markov. Andrei Andreevich Markov. The guy is a great mathematician. And there are some people who basically, whose names are peppered all through AI. And in fact, a lot of math, of course, because they're mathematicians. So Markov is one big guy. The other guy is Bayes. We'll talk about Bayes when we got there. No, Levin Bayes and the probability theory. But Markov, one of the interesting ways you can become way more eternal than your just contributions is people add your name to important concepts. It turns out Markov chains, Markov decision processes. By the way, remember I said Markov decision processes, if you don't have full observability, you'll get PalmDP. What is the equivalent in Markov chains? So you don't see the states. You are seeing your friend through a peephole. You're only getting partial observations. And the police haven't come still and caught you. You're only getting partial observations. And you're trying to figure out through partial observations your friend's transition probabilities from going from one state to another state. That's a kind of a Markov chain, except it's a not fully observable Markov chain. Not fully observable Markov chain. What's the name for it? Is there a name that anybody have heard of? It's called hidden Markov models or HMMs. Markov chain, I told you, is to HMM as MDP is to PalmDP. The only thing different between them is observability. Okay. And so if you remember, I mean, there's like a million applications of Markov chains. The one that I gave you was Google PageRank. Similarly, there are like a million applications of HMMs. One of the most amazing ones until very, very, very recently was HMMs are used for speech recognition. Especially in this era of masks, I think I'm saying something. My head knows what I'm trying to say. Then my Indian accent converts it into some phonemes. Then the mask then translates them into some other phonemes. And that is what you're hearing. And you're trying to convert that into words in English. That's hidden Markov model. In fact, the oldest speech recognition systems used HMMs. Now they no longer do. There are better approaches. Okay. Again, HMMs, there is no, you are only watching. You're a spectator. You're a spectator, but through a peephole. In Markov chain, you're a spectator with front row seat. Okay. Okay. So Markov basically gets named in Markov decision processes, Markov chains, HMMs. There are also all sorts of things called Markov games. Again, fame gets fame. right? So Markov games are essentially the thing that Lisa and Bart were playing, where they need mixed policies, Markov games, right? And then all the variations of MDPs, of course, will have Markov in it, you know, PalmDP, DeckPalmDP, all that stuff. And then there are also other things we'll talk about called Markov chain Monte Carlo. It's like we picked on some names and we keep using them. Markov chain Monte Carlo, it turns out to be a great way of sampling based inference. At some point of time, we talk about it. So Markov is like so important that at one point of time, I hired an MS student to work with me because his name was Elon Markov. My hope was that even if he doesn't do anything, if he writes like one paper, I can be a co-author. Or if he says something, I can say, as Markov said, and people will believe it in AI. Okay, so Elon Markov is a great last name to have in math and in AI. Okay, there used to be an MS student, as I said, whose name was Markov, his last name is Markov. But anyway, okay, this one back. Yeah, so this we answered. Anything else on that? No. Others, actually, I mean, it's like we can talk about this, but what is the A star search equivalent of finite horizon MDP? Yeah?
It's
what?
I think it's greedy.
Say it louder.
I think the equivalent for finite horizon MDP is greedy.
Greedy?
Because from what I understand, can you wait? So for example, in a situation that has a finite horizon, can you wait too long to save? Actually, any choice you make doesn't matter. So you want to make like the best decision like as quickly as possible.
It's not as quickly, right? It's case step look ahead.
Right.
It is a finite horizon MDP says you only live for case steps, where K is the horizon length.
Oh, okay.
An infinite horizon says that you can live as long as you want, as long as you don't die. Unless your free choices lead you to death, nobody is making you die because the time is over. That's infinite horizon MDP. Yes, sir.
It'd be like A star search, but you can only go expand a certain amount of nodes before you're done.
You're close. Think a little differently. You're very close. So he said it's A star search which just expands a number of nodes. He's close, but not quite. He's looking at the wrong. Yes. Exactly. That's it. Finite horizon, Markov processes is to A star search is basically A star search with so basically limited depth A star search. Right somewhere. Limited depth A star search. And it should actually blow your mind because the last time you tried to put a depth limit on A star, I made fun of you. Because when was the last time you tried to put a depth limit on A star? To do ID A star. And I said, no, that's not true. In ID A star, that the limit that you place on the tree is in terms of F value. Very important. ID A star does depth first search in a tree that is truncated using F value cutoff. F value is a real number. In fact, what you would have liked to do for IDA star, most people, you know, think that IDA star must be like depth limited. I mean, like IDDFS, iterative deepening depth first search, is just that you put different depth limits and you do A star inside. And I said, that's dumb. I mean, that's wrong for IDA star. But it turns out that you are just answering a different question. What you're answering is, how would you do finite horizon version of A star search? Okay. The last one, if an infinite horizon MDP has a state with a max reward R max, then what is the upper bound on the value of any state? Yeah, okay. So basically I have something like this, right? I started from S1, let's say some S0, S1, S2, blah, 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 SN. It could be an infinitely long sequence. And it turns out that in every place you will get a little reward. Remember the fact that this infinite state doesn't mean, by the way, here's the other interesting thing. An infinite, okay, this is another true false question. Infinite horizon MDP must have infinite number of states. An infinite horizon MDP must have infinite number of states. I mean, there's a word infinite there. It's not, right? Because the same state can appear infinite number of times in the sequence. If you ever have problem, think about binary numbers. Binary numbers are made of only zeros and ones. They can still be infinitely long sequences, binary sequences. Right? Okay, so this is false. Okay, so all I'm saying is that basically this S0, S6, this is the kth state I observed. That's all. And the actual world state has a valid reward value. And I have to add them all up. Right? If I sum this infinite sequence, I will get infinity. Which is why we basically said we will do gamma power zero or S zero plus gamma power one or S one, gamma power infinity or S. That's what infinite horizon MDPs evaluate, the valuation they get at a given state. Right? Okay. Now the question, of course, is, yeah, it started, I mean, I already made this point that this is sort of a, you know, as long as zero less than or equal to gamma strictly less than one, this would be a geometric series. And so it will be bounded. It won't be infinite, is what I said. What I'm saying is you can get a slightly better in, you know, bound on it. If I were to tell you that the maximum reward value you can get in any state is R max. That's like the maximum reward value you'll ever get. After 10,000 states you have, there's one state which has like say 15 units of reward, and that's the maximum you'll ever get. Then the worst sequence for you would be that state repeated infinite number of times. Right? So in general, you know that any other sequence, its cumulative reward will be less than or equal to, less than or equal to gamma power zero R max plus gamma power one R max plus gamma power two R max, blah, blah, blah. Which is nothing but R max out. 1 plus gamma squared, blah, 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 gamma power infinity. What is this sum? This sum is 1 over 1 minus gamma. Do people know this? As long as gamma is, this is calculus, this is when are infinite summations going to have finite values. As long as gamma is less than one, strictly less than one, then it would be 1/1 minus gamma. So really, all I'm saying is, irrespective of the MDP, the specific trajectory you will ever see, the cumulative reward you can get And any one of the trajectories is going to be R max by 1 minus gamma. Now, given any state, its value is sort of the expected cumulative reward with respect to the policy it is following. It's expectation. So if you take an average of n numbers, the largest of which is 17, you realize that the average can't be more than 17. Right? So the value will never be more than R max by 1 minus gamma for any state. Nice thing. Just used things that you know to get pretty good bounds. You also start realizing that as the gamma becomes close to 1, the value that you can actually achieve keeps growing without bounds. This is only a very loose bound, remember. Okay, and the real value of any state has to be less than this number. But if gamma is close to 1, then that's going to be R max by something close to 0. It's a huge big number. Which is basically what we are saying, that if you live long enough, you might be able to hit the jackpot, depending on the MDP. If you die tomorrow, I'm sorry, if you die right now, I'm sorry. This is the only class where I'll say, I'm sorry for saying you'll die tomorrow and then say you'll die today. But nowhere else can you do this. But today, it's bad. That is the worst thing, honestly. As long as you're alive, there is a possibility that you, by doing the optimal policy, you get the best possible thing, you know, valuation. And that's connected to the fact that I also told you last class that gamma, the closer gamma is to 1, the longer you think you will live. The closer gamma is to 0, the shorter you think you will live. Gamma equal to 0 means this is it, no more actions. Okay? Any questions? Okay, so what I wanted to do originally is to write in front of you slow the MDP Bellman equations, because I have shown it to you multiple times. Some of you might be boring, but you really need to know how to write this. Okay, and I'll do this for finite, infinite value of a policy, optimal value. Okay, just basically slow that you may be able to, you know, showing the slides has advantages, but sometimes writing it might sometimes. So, and since this is one of the most important things, if you can't write a Bellman equation, you're in big trouble. You've seen this, so I'm just going to repeat them for you. Okay, so let's consider finite horizon and infinite horizon here. And actually, let's say finite horizon first. Value of a policy. Value of a policy pi. So what I'm trying to write is, it's a finite horizon. Let's say finite horizon, horizon k. That means you live for k with epochs. Okay, so I'm trying to compute value of this policy pi with k steps to go. This is capital K, this is small k, k steps to go, of some state S, right? That would be, first you will give the reward of being in that state, plus you want to essentially say you do the action that you are supposed to do with k steps to go in this state S, and that action will take you to multiple possible states, and for each of the states you can get to, you will get the value of that state with k minus 1 steps to go, you multiply it by the probability of doing that. This is what you're doing, and it looks quite, you know, when you write it down, it looks kind of complicated. So first transition from S, then you do pi SK, which is an action that the policy says you should do. To S dash, imagine that's the probability. T of S pi SK S dash is the probability. You know, that's the model. With that probability, you will be in S dash, and then you will get the value of S dash, but only K minus one steps to live. Okay. Do people get this? I mean, this is like, I mean, this is like a very fast equation. Again, one of the strangest things to understand is finite horizon is easier to prove theorems, because finite horizon, you start with the zero steps to go, one step to go is in terms of zero steps, two steps to go in terms of one step, and so on. Except the size of the policy itself is much bigger. Right? In general, let's think about the size of the policy. In general, if you have S number of states, I need to know the action to do in each of those states. That's the policy. Except I need to know this with respect to K steps to go, K minus one steps to go, K minus two steps to go, etc. So the policy size is actually K times S. And the value size is the same. Values is also K times S. Because the value depends on the number of steps you have left to go. Okay. Now, if I was doing infinite horizon, basically what I will say is V pi of S, because in infinite horizon case, there is no such thing as number of steps left. You always have infinite number of potential steps left. That's the beauty of infinite horizon. Right? If you have infinite horizon, V pi of S is R of S plus sigma T of S pi S, because the policy itself will just be one state to action mapping. It doesn't need to care about how many steps, because you'll always have infinite number of steps. Right? So instead of pi SK here, you just have pi S. And I may go to S dash, at which point I will get the value of S dash with respect to the same policy. And there is no K minus one, because all values are infinite steps to go. You guys get this? I mean, this is what we were going through. And I kind of realized that, you know, the first time you're seeing it, may or may not. Some of you, it's kind of boring. Some of you, it's not. And I'm hoping that it's hopefully becomes boring to everybody by the end of the course, so that you will know what a Bellman equation is. Okay? The only difference, of course, is I can't do this. If I do this, I'm not discounting. If I'm doing this, I'm not discounting. So I just multiply it by gamma. Multiply this part by gamma. That's the infinite horizon. Value of a policy. So if I were to give you a policy for a Infinite Horizon MDP, let's say there are S states, remember that the value, the size of the policy will be just the size of the number of states. That's it. Policy size is the size of the number of states. Right? And if I were to give you the policy and I ask you what values would you expect in the long term if you keep doing this policy, V pi of S is telling you that. You see what I'm saying? Okay. Now, the interesting thing about this is actually for here, for the finite horizon, there is a base case, which is V pi 0 of S is R of S. That's the base case. And that's how zeroth value function, first level value function, second level value function, and so on. For here, there is no base case. It's just I get S number of unknowns all at once. And those S number of unknowns are connected to each other by this set of equations. Even though it looks kind of strange, really, this is like saying X equal to 2Y plus 3Z, Y equal to 4Z minus 3X, Z equal to 3X plus 4Y. And then I want what is X, Y, Z. You have summed this. This is called the simultaneous linear equation solution. What is the approach you used in high school for this? You can solve from first principles, but you can also solve using Gauss-Jordan elimination, for example. Or if you know matrices, you can do matrix inversion. The good thing is solving simultaneous linear equations is a polynomial time activity. So computing the value of a policy is poly time. Okay. Computing the value of the policy is a poly time. You guys can see in your mind why these are linear equations, right? Because the x's and y's are these. V pi s can be x. And V pi s dash, V pi s dash can be, I mean, this can be x1, this can be x2. And these are numbers. P s pi s s dash is a number, it's a probability. R s is a number, it's a probability. So beneath this tremendous looking formulation, what you have is a bunch of linear equations. So you can solve it these ways. One other way you can solve it, turns out interestingly enough, is if I'm actually trying to solve this, trying to compute this value of a policy, I could do the following thing. I could just set values to be the rewards. And I use this equation as if it is an update, iteratively. And between some number of iterations, the values no longer change. And you say that must be the value of the policy. Which means you need to have a way of figuring out between two iterations if the value function changed. Except value function is a vector of length s. Right, vector is basically value function is a vector of length s. So I need to see if two vectors have changed. One vector, next vector, basically is the next value function. Has there been a big change or if change is too small? There are multiple ways of computing the distances between vectors. The simplest one is what's called the max norm one. What is max norm one? You take pairwise element difference between the two vectors. You'll get the residual vector. You take the maximum absolute value of this residual vector. That's the max norm. And if these two vectors are the same, then by definition, max norm has to be zero. See what I'm saying? So you can keep track of the max norm and see if the max norm is less than some epsilon. Max norm is basically the residual vector's magnitude. And if it is less than epsilon, stop. That's the way you can do policy evaluation. And the cute thing is that I didn't even have to solve the linear equations. I can just use this as update. So this is an iterative method for computing the value of a policy. If you think about it, that's pretty much what you did for the finite horizon case. Given a value, given a policy, I essentially, in the finite horizon case, what did I do? I set V0 to be the baseline. And V1 pi was basically for each state, you know what action you will do. And with respect to that action, you saw which states it's going to, with what probabilities. You multiplied the probabilities by the state's V0 valuations. That plus RS was the V1. It's just that here you could have done it exactly as a linear set of linear equations or as updates. And in fact, people do updates because they're faster. But it could be done in linear. It could be done in polynomial. Any questions on this stuff? Okay, next. I want to now write optimal values for finite horizon as well as infinite horizon. Again, slowly, okay? So optimal value, V star K S. Instead of pi, I put a star. That means it's basically, I'm looking for the maximum value you can get with respect to essentially the optimal policy. Rather than one way of computing optimal policy, I'm sorry, one way of computing optimal value is enumerate all the policies, compute the value for each of them, see which vector is the best. You see what I'm saying? And that would be the optimal policy. But that's like the dumbest thing to do because you're doing humongous amount of repeated. So instead, you take the structure of the thick problem into account, and the beauty is so Vk star of S is once again R of S plus. The interesting thing is in this state S, if I knew the policy, I would know the action. But I don't know the policy. But the optimal policy will give me an action. Let's just call that A. Let's say that I figured out optimal policy and let's call that A. So what would have happened is if A was the optimal action, then this part would have been sigma S dash P S A S dash V K minus 1 S star. Notice that instead of pi S K before, I just put A. The beauty is, even though there are many, 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 many policies, in fact, how many policies are there, by the way? Even for an infinite horizon, it turns out that if there are S number of states, in each state, you can do A different actions. So the total number of policies would be A power S, as A times A times A times A, A power S. That's for infinite horizon, the total number. Okay. What happens to the finite horizon? Are there more policies or less policies? more. I'm telling you, things are hard because we live. I mean, so things are hard exactly for us. We neither live for zero time, in which case it'll be great. Neither do we live for infinite amount of time. We live for approximately 100 years. As I said, depending on whether you do vaccination or not. Right? And so that's finite horizon. That's what we are stuck with. And our lives are hard. Computationally, if you want to use your brain, our lives are hard. Brain-wise. But man, if you use your brain, you can get the big value, the big jackpot. Okay? So this is for finite horizon, infinite horizon. For the finite horizon, the case would be essentially a power s with zero steps to go, a power s with one steps to go, a power s with two steps to go. And in the worst case, you can pick one here, one here, one here, one here. So it's a very simple number of a power s whole power t. Right? So all I'm saying is this is the total number of finite horizons. Policies. While we are at it, what is the total number of infinite horizon value functions? This is the total number of infinite horizon policy functions. What is the total number of infinite horizon value functions? Infinity. Why? Because we are looking at a discrete number of actions per state before. Whereas a value function, just give a real number to each state. How many different ways can you give real numbers to S number of states? How many real numbers, how many different ways can you give a real number to a single state? Infinite number. You see what I'm saying? The number of value functions is infinite. And of course, it's also infinite here. Policies is at least finite. But actually, it is only finite because of the model we are studying, where we said the agent has a discrete number of actions, a number of actions. If you have continuous dynamics, like you need to turn the signal for every little epsilon variation in the degree that you turn the signal, that's a different action. And turn the steering, that's a different action with different outcomes in terms of which lane are you going into, which walls you are hitting. And the continuation action MDP is this, everything is infinite. In fact, much of what we're doing is discrete action MDPs, which are easier to understand. But if you are into continuous action MDPs, all the integrations will be, I'm sorry, all the summations will become integrations. And everything is in. Okay. Fine. Okay, so coming back here, we wrote Vk star s is R of s plus, if in fact A is the action that the policy said, then it will be TSAS dash times V star K minus one of S. Except there are a variety of actions, A equal to, I mean, there are total capital A number of actions. So what I need to do here is max over A. This is where it gets very interesting. There are a power sk times number of different policies. Okay, there are a power sk times number of different policies. But at a given state, they can only change. They can differ from each other in a number of ways. Right? You see what I'm saying? Okay. That's a beautiful thing. So because of it, we are basically saying V star K S is R of S plus max over A. And even here, V star 0 S is R of S. That's the baseline. Okay. Yes.
Minus one, for the optimal value, that should be S dash, right?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, that's correct. This should be S dash. Obviously, right? S dash. Thank you. We showed this multiple times. I'm just slowly walking you through this. You did yourself, you're in good shape. Now, this is for the finite horizon. And you did this by doing that max thing. Remember? I mean, basically, you did the stage by stage, you know, looking at all the actions and picking the best action for each state. For the infinite horizon, things become easy again. V star S equal to R of S plus this, basically more or less this whole thing, max over A S dash T S A S dash V star S dash. Then you put a gamma in the front. Okay? I mean, you can put the gamma inside the max, so it doesn't make any difference. But the gamma is the same for each action. And see, notice the thing that became simpler is there's no k minus one here. Because the number of iterations left is always infinite. Okay? Yes?
What does that max over A notation mean?
Max over A basically, so it's like for different A's, you will compute the number. For different A, suppose you have A1 and A2. Okay, let me actually show you if I can just think we have it. Yeah. See, this is what the maxing was. So there were two actions here. So this is Vt, and there are values at Vt. And there are two actions, a red action, an orange action, and a yellow action. And the orange action will give this. The yellow action will give this. You're taking the max of those two. And you're remembering which action gave you the max. So there is a different, in the notation, there is basically just max means over the different A's, which is the value that's maximum. If you want to remember the policy, you need to remember the arc, but not right now. Don't worry about it. That is the action that made the thing maximum. That's called argmax. That's the notation. Okay, good question. Okay. This is infinite horizon value iteration. Is it? Now, obviously, it's simpler than this. Can it also be written as a set of linear equations? No. Why? Because this monster is there. The max makes it non-linear. If it's just a single action, it would have just been a set of linear equations. Because you're trying to pick which is the best action, in essence, it won't be a set of linear equations. Because of which, actually, value iteration. So if you do this, if you solve this correctly, and there are ways of solving this correctly. Any of you heard of things like linear programming? Yeah, those of you heard of linear programming, you can write this as a linear program. It turns out, not linear equations, but linear program. And it turns out you can solve it that way, which actually is the way to prove that value iteration is actually polynomial complexity, even for infinite horizon MDPs. Do you understand what I'm saying? So in computer science, you know that the complexity of the problem is not based on your solution to that problem. If that was the case, all bets are off, because all of you can come up with exponential solutions to sorting problems. So it looks like, you know, this n factorial is the complexity of sorting, because that's the best I could think of. Complexity, on the other hand, is among all the people around who formed the best policy, the best algorithm. And what is that guy's complexity? So there is an implicit best or min cost being done there. And so when I told you that V star can actually be correctly, exactly solved as a linear program, it turns out that is the way you prove to yourself. I mean, not you did, because if you haven't heard of linear programs, you don't know this. It turns out that linear programs essentially are polynomial class. And it wasn't known for the longest time. And this is a whole entire story about linear programs. It's like, you know, the IE part of the department, industrial engineering, that's their thing. They'll try to convert everything into a linear program or integer program. That's like their first line of defense. Okay. And the first time when linear program was, you know, basically people started talking about, so around the same time Bellman was doing dynamic programming, there was this guy called Danzig, George Danzig, who essentially computed something called a simplex solution for linear programs, which is a pretty darn good solution, except its worst case complexity is exponential. So for the longest time, people didn't know whether value iteration is exponential or not. In fact, if you think in terms of your way of looking at the world, the total values, if you just think in terms of the most brute force approach, checking if any of the value functions you can guess satisfies this solution, and so that would be V star, that would be infinite cost, because you're essentially looking at infinite different value functions. A cheaper one would be, cheaper only in this class, is to guess one of these a power s policies, check what the value function for that is, pick the best value function. That must be the V star. That is at least finite time, because there are only finite number of policies. But it's certainly not polynomial. When I say polynomial, by the way, when people talk about complexity, and they say polynomial, you have to say polynomial what? And in this case, polynomial is the number of states. And this one is certainly not polynomial, the number of states, because S is in the superscript. And it turns out that the reason it's actually polynomial is because you can solve it using linear programming. You think, what the heck is this? I mean, I came to this class and you're saying, I don't know linear programming. And you're saying, that's the only way. No, that's not the only way. It turns out there's a cheaper solution, which is, don't think of it as equal. Think of it as update. The same deal that we did last time. And in fact, that's basically what you were doing here. You're updating level by level by level, where in the case of finite horizon, the levels had physical significance. They meant the value function k levels to go. Here it is just an intermediate value of the value function until it converges. You get that? If you just do this as an update, it's a costlier update. It's a costlier update, but it'll work. But since you're updating, I need to start it off with some values, even though they don't have any significance. So set some values and then keep updating. Now it turns out that it's a reasonable thing to update, set the values to be reward. But there are actually better things to do. For example, if you have a weak heuristic, if it is some sort of a path planning problem and you have a weak heuristic, you put that h value. In essence, what you're computing is h star given h. Okay. So value iteration, the finite horizon case is over. Value iteration, basically, you do the same finite horizon value iteration, except now you act as if it's, you know, you keep doing it until the values from different levels just start off no longer change. So this gets us to showing you something tangible, maybe. I don't know how many of you checked this. this is some sort of a demo of value iteration running in front of you for a grid world. But it, please don't think that MDPs are only good for grid worlds. Just as A star search isn't just good for anything that can be thought of as a graph, A star search is fine. Anything that can be thought of in terms of translation functions, stochastic translation functions, MDP is fine. Okay. So the nice thing about this, and you should play with this, is that you know, I reset this. So if I basically, so it basically currently, you know, if I say value iteration, look what is happening. Do you see that? Now let me show it again. Okay, so reset, toggle. Okay, reset. So right now, basically, I set everything, everyone's rewards. I mean, basically, all the values are set to zero, in a sense. In fact, one of the nice things about value iteration is irrespective of how you initialize the original values, they will converge. It's only a question of speed of convergence. And what is happening in this when I let it run is it's trying to compute the values, you know, first iteration, second iteration, third iteration, where iterations, internal iterations. And one of the things you will see is that the green spreads. The green spreads. Good news spreads. Why? Think about this while I show you again. Okay, so toggle the value iteration. Green essentially meant positive values. That is, the expected cumulative reward you will get from this state, if you do the optimal things, is positive. Life is only not worth living if V star is negative everywhere. Think about this. Life is not worth living. I'm not trying to tell you what to do, but I mean, in general, for random agents, life is not worth living only if V star is negative everywhere. But the reason life is worth living is there are many, many states for which V star is pretty bad, but there are some states for which V star is pretty darn good. You just don't have, you just avoid doing the bad things. That's why we are given a brain. Think about our optimal policy. Upfront, when you're starting to think, how good is my life? It looks pretty bad because, you know, the states might, you may be surrounded by neighbors, neighboring states, who are also pretty clueless. And your value is based on your neighbor's value. It's like, you know, MDP value update in the value iteration is basically like people's house values, which go down because your neighbor is not, for crying out loud, mowing their lawn. Do you understand what I'm saying? I've read this once that in US, people don't mind having pretty much any kind of criminal as their neighbor, but they can't stand a neighbor who doesn't mow their lawn and who keeps their lawn unclean. Why? Because that guy's valuation goes down, so my valuation goes down. Right? So in essence, actually, the state's value depends on the value of its neighbors. That's what we were doing in all those things. Upfront, you are clueless as to whether or not there is a good path to happiness in life. So are your neighbors, who are also clueless. But then the neighbors of the people who are happy states, they get the message after one iteration. That will then spread. That will then spread. In fact, the way that value iteration occurs, interestingly, if you look at the value of a single state, look at maybe this guy's value. It's right now 0.22 and it's positive. It started at zero. In fact, in some cases, it might become negative only to become positive. That's what they say. It looks bad, but if you think, there is like much better stuff that's about to happen in terms of value iteration. You see what I'm saying? The other interesting thing is that you can play with this in all sorts of ways. Sagalaitan said. And the policy valuation is, it basically takes a policy and computes the value. The same thing as value is doing, except it's doing only for a given policy. This is a computer. If you are doing it, you have to do the actual max over operation, but it's a computer, does it fast enough, whether it is just a single action expectation or max over k number of actions. In this particular case, the number of actions are up, down, left, right. That's it. Okay? Right? That's basically about Infinite Horizon value iteration. The last thing I want to say before we get done today is, actually I wish I had an extra page, but I don't. So it turns out that, let me see if I can do this. It turns out that these are all written in terms of R of S, which is you get the reward as soon as you get to the state. When you get to the MDP projects, we actually use a slightly different model. And that model is RSAS dash. That means you get the reward for the transition, not for the state. If you do that, this equation looks the same, except this RS, instead of being outside, will go inside. And it will be RSAS dash, because until you pick the action, you don't know what reward you're going to get. Okay, so it looks as if the equation is quite different, because it would be more like V star S is max over A of max over A of sigma over S dash. R S A S dash plus T S A S dash times V star S dash. That's how this new model will look like. But it's the same idea. It's a question of when you get there. And you can also write this whole set of equations, not in terms of V, the value, but J, the cost. And the difference would be minimization rather than maximization. Okay. And then very last thing is that there is a different idea called policy iteration that I'll talk to you next time. And what that does is kind of mind-boggling. And I just want to kind of mention it before you go off so that it will make you sad as to why does this work, which is the number of policies is finite, right? Values are not, policies are finite. So here's my idea. I'll pick a policy, just random policy. That means for each of these states, I have to pick an arrow direction. Having picked the policy, I'll compute the value of the policy using the policy valuation. Having picked the value, I will compute the greedy policy, which is if this was the real value, then each state will look at only its neighbors, just one step look ahead, and sees which action gives it the maximum returned value. It's the greedy policy. Turns out that the greedy policy normally would be different from the policy you started from. If it isn't, then you can say the same policy came after two iterations, that's the optimal policy. Because it turns out only for the optimal value is the greedy policy the same as the optimal policy. How do you understand this? Think of when is in real-time A star search, under what conditions can the myopic one level look ahead give you the optimal path? If your evaluation function is H star. If your evaluation function is H star, then anybody can do myopic search. So policy iteration essentially uses that. And it says, if the policy changes, then now compute the value of this new policy. Take the greedy policy with respect to that value and keep doing this until the policies don't change between two iterations. And since the policies are discrete, it's very easy to check whether they change between two iterations or not. And that's policy iteration. That's at least actually guaranteed to stop in finite number of iterations because there are only finite number of policies. Think about why this makes sense. But as I said, the connection is H star. Connection is, if you have H star, the one step look ahead will give you the optimal action.
I want to get the word to the number.